观众朋友您好，欢迎收看今天的茶余饭后节目，我是卓磊。那么中国的电影和电影人呢越来越受到世界的瞩目，大家都知道啊，这个剧本是一剧之本，导演呢是一部戏的灵魂，如果说这部戏还有大明星出演的话，那么它的票房一定还是不错的。那么说到导演，中国的陈凯歌、张艺谋，还有台湾的李安、香港的吴宇森等等，他们都是世界级的。那么陈凯歌呢，他是出身于电影世家，他的父亲陈怀凯呢是中国著名的电影艺术家。与众不同的是，陈凯歌他深厚的中国文学的功底使他的电影带上了浓厚的文学色彩。前段时间陈凯歌来到洛杉矶，那么下面我们来看一看陈凯歌同李斌的一席谈话。
观众朋友，今天非常荣幸的访问到中国大陆的著名导演陈凯歌。陈导演，凯歌你好。
你好，你好，
欢迎接受我们茶余饭后节目的专访。
是是，谢谢。
就在这个风云那马上要在美国上映了哈，在这个时候能不能给我们所有在全美国的观众朋友哈介绍介绍这个电影。这个风月呢好像是反映20年代在上海的事儿。
嗯，
然后我们在美国的观众朋友呢最近也都看了，去年哈有看过那个张艺谋导的那个摇啊摇，摇到外婆桥，那也是关于上海题材的一个电影。就能不能谈谈您这个电影有什么不一样的，有谈的什么样的题材，什么样的故事。
故事是很不同的一个故事，因为大家都问这个问题，就是说是不是这为什么同时都在上海拍，都是上海的故事。但是我想这完全是个巧合，这之前没有做过任何的沟通或者商量。题材是很不同的，我想他那个题材是有一点牵扯到上海旧时代那个黑帮啊等等。我想这个我这个戏是比较讲在一个时代的变动之下，就是说这个人们会怎么面对他们所遇到的所有这些问题，其中包括心理上的问题。这个我想就是很多的这个观众可能都了解到，我想这个今天在大陆很多的发生了很多变化，经济上的变化，社会的变化，这些变化而且都是很快的。这样大的社会变动一定会对所有的个人个体造成某种影响，所以最主要的想法还是想在这样一个社会变动的情况下来看看这个所有这些个体的这个怎么去面对这些问题啊。这个是拍这样一个戏的基本想法。
在中国有拍电影几种手法哈，比如说看您的那个《霸王别姬》，那个好像我觉得看是一种那个史诗的效果，一个很大的一个大场面的一个史诗性的剧。但有一种电影的拍法呢是另外一个，就是通过一个发现很小的一个小家庭一个个人来看一个整个社会的变化。
嗯，
那您这个《风月》的话是属于哪一种？
《风月》应该属于后边这一种，它也有一点场面，但是不是很多。我觉得呢，这就是我们所说的这一滴水可以见大海了，一滴水可以见阳光了。你实际上是通过一个很微小的社会组织，是吧？一个家庭组织，家庭中间生活的这样的一些具体的个人，是吧？来看他们，在一个变动时代中间的情形，你可以反射到这个整个社会变化的情况，我觉得。基本上是一种以小见大的方式吧。
嗯，那么跟您的那个《霸王别姬》比起来，这个《风月》有什么不一样？更有特点的地方在哪里？
我想我一直有兴趣去拍一些不同的题材啊，特别是自己不完全熟悉的题材。比如举例来说，《霸王别姬》是发生在北京的故事，我是出生在北京的，所以我对北京是比较了解，对京剧呢也有一定的了解。但是对上海这样一个环境对我来说是很陌生的，但是我觉得正因为陌生，所以我觉得有更大的兴趣。我觉得上海曾经是这个傲视群雄的亚洲的金融中心啊，在30-40年代曾经有过极大的繁荣的这样一个国际性的都市。那么我就想，当所有这些人从不同的地方进入这个都市的时候，他们面对的情况是什么样的，是吧？他们这些人怎么样能够在上海这样一个城市居住下来，是吧？能够逐渐的去发现他们自己在这个社会中间的位置，这个过程一定是充满了很多痛苦的，一定是有很多痛苦的。所以我自己都觉得，就是任何一个地区的繁荣，大概都是以 精神上是情感上的极大代价，这个作为基础的是吧，你才能够出现这样一个繁荣的情况。
我是来自上海，您这个故事反映的上海的事儿。其实我虽然是来自上海，但是呢，我是因为父母亲上海人，但是我本人是在外地长大的。那回到上海之后呢，感觉非常多，
嗯，
但是呢，待的时间越长，我在上海待了八年，
嗯，
待的时间越长呢，越感觉到这个社会太复杂，太有深度，
嗯，
太有东西可以挖掘，
嗯，
很难，就是完全能够诠释得清楚。你要我解释一下上海是怎么样一个城市，很难解释得清，太复杂，
嗯，
太多层面了。
是，
所以您觉得您看上海？就在拍这个电影之前，您觉得您对上海这个文化的了解是怎么样子的？
我想和北京非常不同，因为它可以说是，在这个自己发展的这样一个过程中间，产生了一种，非常丰富的市民文化。那，它不是学者式的，它不是那种北京啊那样一种这个故国古都啊。啊，很多的文化遗存呢，啊，很多的这种好像深刻的这种所谓遗产，它是一种很世俗化的东西。但这种世俗化的东西，同时又是很生动的、很有生命的一些东西。
那这个电影里面呢，您还是启用了那个张国荣啊，能不能谈谈，就是为什么在这个片子，您还是用您在那个《霸王别姬》里面的主要演员？
因为我想他所扮演的这个在风月中扮演的角色，基本上是一个，就是过去上海人讲话就是拆白党，他是一个，是吧，是一个放白鸽的人物。那么我自己就觉得张国荣的表演技巧很高，对人物的这种很能够理解，所以他要是这种人物，他演起来应该是驾轻就熟的。而且他又有一张所谓俊脸，是吧，这个你要说他演一个拆白党是很合适的，所以大概是这么一个原因。大家呢合作愉快，都有再度合作的愿望，所以就一起再做一次。
当时在选用巩俐之前，当时有没有考虑过巩俐演员？她也是北方人，她也许演那个北方角色比较合适，但演着上海的角色，您觉得当时有没有一股顾虑，或者是当时怎么选中他的？
原来
能谈谈
这事儿，原来是有是选过另外的人的，啊，一个台湾的女演员，但是就是沟通上面的一些困难啊，这个就是在拍摄到一定程度的时候就等于放弃了，重新再开始。从气质上看吧，巩俐是不大像南方人，这倒是真的。但是呢并不影响他去表演，因为他也是应该说是有很丰富经验的这样一个演员，他也能够很顺理成章的去理解拍摄他的人物。
Mr. Moore, congratulations for your new portrait in the movie of The Quest.
Thank you very much.
So, when I see you, I still see you as the 007, the secret agent, James Bond.
I'm not carrying anything.
You don't carry anything? Oh, I feel safe. So, tell us your experience in this movie, The Quest. Is there any difference between your experience in this movie and your previous movies?
Well, certainly a great deal of difference, because in this I'm not, as you saw the film, I'm not the hero, and so therefore I didn't have to get up every morning and be in every shot. which was a great change and a great relief.
Yeah, I think in this movie, your character gives it a very another dimension of it. It's like a very comic relief, you know, that part of it. That's just so gorgeous.
Well, I thought I was the comic relief in Bond as well.
You know, our audience still remember you as the James Bond in the 007. You were just after the Sean Connery, he did that show.
Yes, Sean did five, then George Lazenby did one, then Sean came back and did number six, and then I was number seven, and then I did six more after that. So I did seven, Sean did six, Lazenby did one, Timothy Dalton did two, and Pierce Brosnan has just completed one.
Right.
It's a sort of a long saga.
Yeah, it's a long time ago also. So what kind of remembrance you still have about that experience in the 007?
Very fondly. You know, it was, we made one every 2 years. So I had time to do one or two pictures in between so that I varied my life somewhat. We went to exotic places. I saw a great deal of the world that I wouldn't see if I had to write the check and buy the airline tickets. The group of people that I work with making Bond, particularly Cubby Broccoli, who was a very dear friend, making the films, I had a wonderful time.
What is the most unforgettable moment when you're shooting that movie?
When I got paid. What in making Bond? Oh, there's so many. Most, you know, suddenly you remember the painful ones. I remember getting blown up many times. Remember all the knocks and bruises. But I remember the laughs. We had so much fun, and particularly with one director, Lewis Gilbert, that I made Moonraker with, and The Spy Who Loved Me. And we would laugh all day, and it was wonderful. It was sort of. It was a game every day.
Sure.
Lewis
having
would say,
fun, isn't it?
Yeah. What are you going to say today? He'd say. I said, don't you want me to say what's in the script? He said, well, you got something better to say? I said, yeah, let's try things. And we
would
try.
So can you take liberty to say whatever you want?
Oh, yes. We used to have take a lot of liberties, right. Have fun with the lines. The whole point was for me to make it fun. And that thereby hopefully transfer that fun to an audience and say, look, I'm having fun. We want you all to have fun.
Sure, absolutely. So, do you still think that's the best movie you think, or which movie is the best you think you have done so far?
Of what I've done?
Mm-hmm.
I have no idea what is the best.
You personally think it's the best.
In terms of finances, I suppose Bond. You know, but I made, I suppose, about 300 films for television, you know, in episodes of series. I've enjoyed them all. In films, I have enjoyed things where I've played something a little further away from myself. One in particular, a picture called The Man Who Haunted Himself, in which I was a doppelganger. It was a man's good and evil, and I played both characters. That was fun to play. That was sort of acting.
Split personality.
I rather enjoyed a film I made with a director I liked very much called Andrew McLaglen, and the movie was called, amongst other things, Folks, or North Sea Hijack, or they gave it all sorts of titles. But I was allowed to have a beard and say outrageous things, be a misogynist, and do needlework and drink whiskey from the bottle.
I heard that you have once worked in Hong Kong with some Chinese actors or
Yes, we directors. Shot, quite a lot of Man with a Golden Gun there. We shot there and then we moved on to Thailand, in fact, to Phuket. Where I went back again with the quest after, I suppose, an interval of probably 20 years. Changed a great deal.
Why do you want to do the job in the UNICEF?
Why? Because somebody has to do it.
Why you?
Why? Because Audrey Hepburn got me involved. I realized that why I was asked to do it is because I was well known as an actor. Otherwise people wouldn't, you know, the press wouldn't come along and listen to you. So for that reason I continue to make films when I can, because I have to keep the name and the face alive. Well, it's a bit difficult keeping this face alive, but, you know, it has to be done.
Is there anything else you want to say to our Chinese audience?
I want them if they like the film, to tell their friends, and if they don't, forget it.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Did you see him?
Yes, of course I saw him. Just keep moving.
Did you see him?
Chris, we were looking for you, weren't we?
Yeah, we were looking for you.
Good to see you again, my boy. Put on a little muscle. I'm famous. I always said you'd make it.
You owe me.
Yes, I do, Chris. And I always repay my debts. What do you want?
The Golden Dragon.
Golden what?
The Golden Dragon in the Lost City.
Lost City?
The best fighters will meet to compete in secret for a big dragon made of solid gold.
What exactly do you want me to do?